You have Esper charms and O-rings to blow them up, but him hitting our colony there was definitely helpful for us. Didn't have to waste mana activating it. We didn't lose our black mana. That guy will be good once we get him online. Just gonna draw some cards. Hopefully he doesn't have another negate. Can't imagine he's running more than about two negates in the main deck. Son of a... So this list is definitely different than I would have expected. It's giving us a little bit of trouble. Like I said, this is not the greatest match. Like, I think post-board, you're maybe slightly favored. I don't even know if that's... I mean, Duress is really huge, as is Negate, and you bring in Gideon and an O-Ring, and Identity Crisis. You just basically bring in all kinds of cards that are actually relevant. And normally, you also upgrade your pass to Doomblades, but because you're playing with Persecutor, you can't really afford to do that, so you just have to use your pass correctly. You should be activating Colonnade here, if I had to guess. A Chalice. Alright, yeah, this is definitely... It's almost like an old-school list. Alright, so we do have a turn of him... Not going to be able to do anything. Get rid of that. The other option, so we added a second Doomblade over the main deck Identity Crisis, and the other option was to add a Mindspring. So something worth noting that we could potentially have a Mindspring in our deck, but we don't. We still have Jaces and whatnot that we haven't drawn. He hasn't drawn his Jace either, so that's fine. I'm sure he has some type of removal for this guy. Probably just a Day of Judgment, but can't just sit back and not run him out. This Elspeth's going to probably get us to the point where... I mean, I guess Indestructibility is not the biggest thing in this matchup, since I have a lot of things that remove things from the game. I haven't drawn an O-ring yet. Getting two Esper Charms counters is a pretty big deal, though. Be up four cards right now. Maybe he does not have a Wrath. It would seem weird to run... I mean, either he hasn't drawn it yet or doesn't have him in his deck, and I would assume he hasn't drawn it yet. It seems weird to run a blue-white control without Day of Judgment, but... Could be a meta call. I don't know what he cut for the negates, so maybe... Because he has negates and Everflowing Chalice, which aren't really commonplace in the new lists. This looks like a Wrath, though. No, this is bigger than a Wrath. Save Baneseer Angel. Okay. Protection from demons. So he obviously does not have a Wrath, which is good for us. We'll obviously be passing a Baneseer Angel. Creeping Tar Pit's another card that's really good in this matchup, too. Just the ability to get at their Jaces and stuff. People always forget about Creeping Tar Pit, so they'll play a turn 4 Jace and then Brainstorm and almost always lose their Jace. He F6, so he doesn't have a counter spell either. Oh, he did have a pass. Okay. We are almost out of basics, but I guess due to spring change, we'll get... We have three swamps, three plains, and two islands. I don't know what happened to our other... We have... Oh, those are both swamps. Okay. Well, let's keep playing big old dudes, I suppose. This is the part in the game where you can take over. Like, he's going to have Elspeth active, so that's annoying, but at the same time, he has to continuously deal with our threats, whereas he doesn't have must deal with threats, so to speak. Oh, he has an O-ring, though. Fair enough. This game's basically over. You really need to get a Jace active in game one to have the recurring card advantage. Game two, you have Identity Crisis, which also makes up for that, and you have an additional Gideon. But game one, you're basically just trying to one-for-one them a bunch until you play a threat, which is usually card advantage, but in this case, not. I'm just going to continue to play. We really have no chance this game, but I just want to see what other cards he has, since he has a unique build of the deck. Alright, and that's all she wrote. Again, I'll see if he plays something weird. I don't know what. Kissity Misha, maybe. Do love me a Kissity Misha. And we're dead. Alright, so bad cards come out. Walls. Day of Judgments. In comes Oblivion Ring. Negates. Duresses. And now here's the interesting. So we can leave in removal for our Persecutor. But like, I don't think we need these Doomblades anymore, because we still have four pass for his things, and we're bringing in other cards to interact with him. So we're really just looking to hit Manlands and Gideon with these. So I think it's fine to take those out for our Identity Crisis. Then now you're at the point where you need to figure out what to do to bring in this Gideon, because he's the last card I want in there. And all of our cards are very good against him at this point. Maybe we just leave him on the side. So normally, like, an Identity Crisis would have been main, and then we wouldn't have to bring it in. I could take out a path, I suppose. And then just ignore how many that would give us. 3, 7, 11. It would give us 14 ways to deal with a Persecutor, which is probably enough. Pass not super exciting this matchup. I mean, you're basically just looking to hit Manlands with it and Gideon, so fine taking in a Gideon since it does half that job for you. Our mana curve is a little bit worse now, but that's fine since the matchup doesn't really warrant for much else. And our sideboard's just a bunch of removal, so that's good. And we'll be back for game two.